Good morning. I want to welcome everyone to our service this morning, both those of you who are here and those who are watching over television. And I guess I should wait until they get the candles lit.
Maybe you need a blowtorch.
I know how that feels.
Yeah.
Well, I think at my daughter's wedding, they went out after they lit them. That was nice. Thanks, guys. Baptists don't do candles very well. I don't know. For those of you who are visiting, we want to give you a special welcome and ask you to fill out the little form on the bulletin. The announcements, there's a whole raft of them in the bulletin. Some of them need to be pointed out. The youth ministry team meeting that is scheduled for tonight at 5 o'clock has been rescheduled to Wednesday night at 6 o'clock in the Langford Room. Also, you will note on the left side of the bulletin there are 5 new classes beginning here tonight at 6 o'clock. The youth that have signed up for the Supertones concert need to get their $5 in today to reserve their tickets. And the senior adults will be traveling to Williamsburg to eat lunch, and it's coming in on Wednesday, February the 7th, and then they'll be touring the area, so you need to note that. If you want to update the prayer list, Lawrence Giles is in the UT hospital now. And one further thing, the Valentine's banquet is scheduled for Monday night, a week from tomorrow night, the 12th. There's a sign-up sheet downstairs outside the chapel.
Let's stand together as we begin our worship and sing our opening hymn of praise, 231, Come Christians, Join to Sing. Let's stand, please.
Invocation this morning, I'd like to ask you that we bow our heads as I read from the 95th Psalm. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands form the dry land. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
This time we'll ask the children to come forward for the children's sermon. Glad to have you here today. The subject today for your extended session is prayer. Can anybody tell me what prayer is? What's prayer?
Praying to God.
It's praying to God, okay. Well, what do you do when you pray to God?
Forgive your sins.
Okay, you may ask Him to forgive you your sins. But how would you define prayer? How would you explain it to somebody?
You talk to God.
You talk to God. Great, Zach, that's a great answer. Prayer is talking to God. And it's something that Jesus wants us to do. Every day that we ought to talk to God, we ought to talk to Jesus. We just got through praying together a prayer that's called the Lord's Prayer. Do y'all know the Lord's Prayer? Our Father who art in heaven, we pray that every week. And it's a beautiful prayer, and it's a prayer that Jesus gave us as an example of how we might pray. And I'm so glad He gave us that example because it teaches us several things. First of all, it tells us that prayers don't have to be long. Does it take a long time to pray the Lord's Prayer? Doesn't take very long at all, does it? So all of our prayers don't have to be long. There may be times when we do need to spend long periods in prayer, but not all prayers have to be long. Is it real wordy? Is it hard to pray real fancy words? It's not that either, is it? All of us can pray the Lord's Prayer. So I'm so thankful that God gave us the Lord's Prayer through Jesus. And it has all the basics of prayer covered in it. We talk to God as our Father. He's like a loving parent, like a mom or dad in heaven. And it's important that we remember that He loves us, He's close to us, but He's also in heaven. He's far above us. We also pray in the Lord's Prayer that His name be hallowed. That doesn't mean His name is hallowed. It means that we pray that His name would be honored, that all that God stands for would be of great value. And then we go in the Lord's Prayer to pray that His kingdom would come. And that means that we pray His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And when we pray that, we mean in our own lives too, that we pray that God's will be done in your life and my life, just like it's done in heaven. And then what do we pray next for? Do you know the Lord's Prayer well enough to know? We pray for daily bread. Yeah, so God says it's okay for us to pray about the things we need in life, like things to eat. We pray for that. But we pray for not just ourselves, but it's our daily bread. So we pray for everybody, for those who might not have food to eat too. We also ask that God would forgive us our sins, right? And we are reminded when we pray that we are supposed to forgive other people their sins too. And then we also ask God for protection, asking Him to lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And then we go on to again give Him praise by saying, "For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever." And that's something, boys and girls, every one of you can do every day is pray the Lord's Prayer or talk to God. And that's what Jesus wants us to do. That's what He's taught us to do. Well, let's practice what we're talking about, and let's all pray to Jesus right now. Let's do that. Dear Jesus, we thank You for this day, and we thank You for the chance to come to this place to worship You. And we do want to worship You. We want to praise You and give You the glory that You deserve. Father, I thank You so much for these children, and I pray that as they go through their life, they'll learn how important prayer is and that they'll spend time each day talking to You and listening to You as well, for we know that's a big part of prayer too. And I pray that will be something not just the children do, but all of us will do. Help us to spend time with You day by day so that we can come to know You better and love You more. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. Have a great day at church today. Our fellowship hymn this morning is number 333, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. We'll ask you in a moment to stand and sing with us that wonderful hymn of our faith. But before we do that, we'll stand and greet the folks around us. We especially welcome those of you who are visiting with us today. We do have guests, and we're always thrilled when people come visit with us here at First Baptist. We hope you'll feel most welcome. Crawford mentioned there is a little form you can fill out, and we'd appreciate it if you would do that and return it later in the offering plate so that we can have a record of your visit with us today. But thanks for coming, each of you. We certainly welcome you. Let's stand and greet those around us. In a moment, we'll sing 333, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. As you take your seats, I invite you to turn in your pew Bibles to Psalm 89. Each week at this time in our service, we read from the Psalms, which has been the prayer book of the church for the ages. And so today we read together, but we also pray together. Psalm 89, verses 1 through 18. Psalm 89, verses 1 through 18. Let's read together. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you established your faithfulness in heaven itself. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant. I will establish your line forever and make your throne firm through all generations. The heavens praise your wonders, O Lord, your faithfulness too in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all who surround him. O Lord God Almighty, who is like you? You are mighty, O Lord, and your faithfulness surrounds you. You rule over the surging sea. When its waves mount up, you still them. You crush Rahab like one of the slain. With your strong arm, you scattered your enemies. The heavens are yours, and yours also the earth. You founded the world and all that is in it. You created the north and the south. Tabor and Hermon sing for joy at your name.
Your arm is endued with power. Your hand is strong. Your right hand exalted. Righteous and justice are the foundation of your throne. Love and faithfulness go before you. Blessed are those who have learned to acclaim you, who walk in the light of your presence, O Lord. They rejoice in your name all day long. They exult in your righteousness, for you are their glory and strength, and by your favor you exalt our horn. Indeed, our shield belongs to the Lord, our King, to the Holy One of Israel.
Our hymn of response is Great is the Lord, page 12. As we sing this, we will sing it one time through.
Together. Our Father, as we gather here today, we certainly do want to affirm your greatness. We want to acknowledge your faithfulness throughout all generations. We want to praise you for your mercy and for your power. And truly, you are worthy of glory. You are worthy of praise. And Lord, that is one reason why we gather here today, to give you that. We are reminded in your word this morning that even your creation offers you praise, that all around us there are signs of your greatness. And I pray these signs will lead us to praise and worship you day by day. We also read in your word of your faithfulness, your mercy, and your love for us. And we celebrate that this morning. We also read in your word of your presence with us at all times, in good times as well as in bad. And today we claim your presence even here in our midst this morning, and we thank you for your presence. Lord, you're such a good God, and we cannot thank you enough for all you do for us. And as we think about your greatness, your holiness, your purity, your light, we cannot help but be reminded that we are not the people we should be, that too often we stray, too often we fail you, too often we let you down. So today we confess our sins before you and claim anew your forgiveness and grace. Thank you for being a forgiving God. Thank you for being patient with us. And Father, having forgiven us, I pray that you would help us to forgive those who trespass against us, that you will help us to be patient with others too. Lord, I thank you for this church. I thank you for the light it is in this community. I thank you for its rich history and for its bright future. And I thank you, Father, for the people who make up this church, who day by day seek to serve you. And I pray that you would help us to be faithful to the calling you have placed upon us. Help us to do the best job we can of loving you and serving you. And we realize part of that means caring for the needy, reaching out to those who are lost and unchurched. Lord, help us to be faithful to this calling. We pray today for those who are sick. There are so many who are struggling with their health right now. We pray for those in the hospital, for those in the nursing homes. We pray for those who are in their own homes this morning, not feeling well. Lord, we also lift up to you this morning those who grieve. So many in our community who are hurting today because of the loss of loved ones, and we ask that your Spirit would comfort them. Father, there are many other needs represented in this room, as well as by those who watch by television. And we're so thankful that you're such a great God that whatever our needs are, we can bring them to you and know that you are able, truly able, to meet our needs. Father, you are so good to us, And I pray that through our worship today that we might offer to you a pleasing sacrifice, that we might truly worship you in spirit and in truth. And Father, in the process, I also pray that we might receive a blessing this morning, that you would open our minds and hearts, our ears, to hear your word, so that we might know what it is you want us to do today or in the week to come. May your will be done here today, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand and turn to hymn 486, Lord, Here Am I. Please stand. First Timothy chapter 6, there's Paul's charge to Timothy. Command those who are rich in the present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. Let us pray. Our Father, most of us confess that much of the time we're forgetful. We forget how comfortable our homes are. We forget how much food is in our cupboards. We forget how many clothes are in our closets. We forget how fat our bank accounts are. We forget that it's not money but the love of money that's the root of so much evil in our world. We forget how secure and safe and blessed we are. We forget that, like any good parent, you want us to love and care for one another. And most of all, we forget that you became one of us to show us what we should be. Our prayer today is to help us to remember. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, choir, for that uplifting anthem. Let me ask you to turn in your Bibles to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. In a moment, we'll read together verses 1 through 7. Ephesians chapter 4, 1 through 7 is our text this morning. As you turn there, let me tell you about a priest and his parishioner who were playing golf one day. And the parishioner noticed that every time the two got onto the greens and the priest prepared to putt, he would pause and cross himself before putting. And every time he did so, he sunk his putt. And after four rounds of this, he couldn't take any more. He said, "Father, does that really work?" He said, "Well, sure it works." So on the fifth hole, when they got to the greens, the parishioner crossed himself, stepped up, took his putt, and missed by a foot and a half. He said, "Father, I thought you said it worked." He said, "Well, it does, but you also have to know how to putt." Remember that. Ephesians 4, 1 through 7. Let's read together God's word today. "As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it." May God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word today. You have probably heard the saying, "Put feet to your prayers." It's a saying that reminds us that there are times when we need to do more than just pray. We need to act on our prayers. Much as the person who was golfing and crossed himself needed to do more than just that, he needed to practice if he wanted to sink his putts. This morning, I'd like for us to consider something of a takeoff on this popular saying. For as you read through the book of Ephesians, you almost hear Paul saying, "You folks need to put feet to your faith." Reading from the New King James Version, Ephesians 4:1 says, "Walk worthy of the calling with which you were called." From there, Paul goes on to give us four more times where he uses the word "walk" and summons us to walk a walk that is befitting of the gospel that we bear. He is very insistent that we live a life, or that we walk a walk, that is consistent with the gospel we share. This morning, I'd like for us to take those five usages of the word "walk" in the book of Ephesians and let them reveal to us some ways that we can put feet to our faith. To begin with, if we are going to put feet to our faith, we must walk in the fellowship of the body of Christ. In Ephesians 4:1, we find the first of the five uses of Paul's word "walk." And in this section of Ephesians 4, Paul is discussing the Christian and his or her relationship with the church. In verses 1 through 6, Paul encourages us to keep the unity of the Spirit. And this really is important, for the church is like a finely tuned instrument that must be maintained and sustained. For this to happen, it takes our best and continued efforts. If it gets out of tune, unfortunately, the message is often unclear. And certainly nothing makes the church's message more unclear than when its members fuss and fight with one another, when they fail to live in peace and unity. For that reason, Paul says, we must strive to maintain the unity of the church, the body of Christ. But he also says we must endeavor to support the church. In verses 7 through 16, Paul talks about spiritual gifts and encourages us to use our spiritual gifts in the ministry of the church. In fact, Paul lets us know here that the reason why God gave to each and every Christian spiritual gifts is for the upbuilding or edification of the church. In order for a church to function properly, to be effective, every member of the church must use his or her gifts. I guess you could say that a church in many ways is like a football team. The football team has a coach. You have a quarterback. You have halfbacks, fullbacks. You have centers. You have receivers, linemen. You have tackles. And on and on you go till you get down even to the water boy. And every individual on that team is essential and has a role to play if that team is to be successful. Any part that does not support the whole diminishes the whole. And the very same thing can be said about the church. If we are going to put feet to our faith, we must be team players who work side by side for the cause of Christ. We do not advance the kingdom of God as isolated individuals, but rather together as the body of Christ. Second, if we are to put feet to our faith, we must display a new character. In Ephesians 4:17, Paul challenges us to walk not as the Gentiles walk. In verse 22, he explains what he means by this by saying, "Your hearts and minds must be made completely new." This is elsewhere translated, "Put off your old nature, which belongs to your former manner of life." In this section, Paul listed some of the things which we ought to put off. He listed things like lying, anger, stealing, and harmful words. It's clear here that the Christian is expected to have a new character. Well, one of the most wonderful and foundational truths of the gospel is that Jesus Christ gives us just this. He gives us a new character. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, Paul says, "If any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things become new." The reason many of us are not putting feet to our faith is because we are not displaying our new character. As we've seen, Paul insists that we put off our former manner of life. Oh yes, Jesus does give us a new character when we become Christians, but we must do our part in cleaning up our act. And furthermore, we are not only to rid our lives of certain things which are inappropriate for a child of God, but Paul says there are also certain things we should put on. In Colossians 3, Paul suggested things like compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. He went on to say that we ought to be tolerant with one another and forgive one another. I'm afraid that all too often our testimony is killed by actions which are inappropriate for Christians. Do we really practice what we preach? Does our walk, our life, always support our profession? If not, let's not be surprised if the community around us doesn't get real excited about coming to church. Who can blame folks for shunning the church if all they ever see is people who talk the talk but who do not bother to walk the walk? My guess is that when they begin to see Christ's character exhibited in us day by day, then and only then will they be responsive to our attempts to reach out to them. Third, if we are to put feet to our faith, we must be motivated by love. In Ephesians 5:2, Paul tells us to walk in love. In fact, he challenges us here to walk and to love as Christ loved us and gave his life for us as a sweet-smelling offering and sacrifice that pleases God. You know as well as I do that Jesus loved us so much that he laid down his life for us. And if we are going to have an impact on our own community with other people in the world at large, then we too must be a people who walk in love, whose motivation is always love. Many times we do not put feet to our faith because that love is missing. In 1 Corinthians 8 and 9, Paul deals with a very sensitive issue, but he lays down for us a principle that should become a guiding principle in each of our lives. The issue that he is dealing with in this section of Scripture is whether it is right or wrong to eat meat which has been sacrificed to idols. Paul concludes that there's really nothing wrong with eating such meat in and of itself, but he goes on to say that if our eating that meat causes a brother to stumble or fall, then we should abstain. Let love guide you, is the principle Paul taught. You know today we're no longer faced with that question of whether it's right or wrong to eat meat which has been offered to idols. That's not a controversy anymore. But certainly we still face a number of controversial issues. And I'm afraid too often our response to these issues Issues such as abortion, AIDS, and welfare have shown anything but love. Folks, we must always weigh our actions by the measure of love. And here we don't get the choice of making up our own definition of love so that it somehow fits all of our prejudices. Paul specifically says we are to love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a sacrifice on the cross at Calvary. In order to put feet to our faith, we must walk the path of love. Fourth, if we are to put feet to our faith, we must walk consistently. In Ephesians 5:8, Paul says, "Once you were in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light." In the following verse, Paul goes on to tell us, "It is the light that brings a rich harvest of every kind of goodness, righteousness, and truth." In the New International Version, this passage reads, "For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth." As you well know, fruit trees are expected to bear fruit consistent with their nature. Apple trees produce apples. Peach trees produce peaches. Orange trees produce oranges. Failure to do so creates many questions. If I plant an apple tree and it bears peaches, I have to ask, what went wrong? Did I plant the wrong kind of tree? Did someone switch the labels? Even so, a child of God is expected to bear fruit consistent with the character of God. As people look at our lives, they should be seeing goodness and righteousness and truth. But is that what they are seeing? If not, there's certainly some of the same questions can be raised. Is something wrong here? Is this person really a Christian? Has someone switched the labels? For too often, our inconsistency does, in fact, betray us. Let me ask you, how would you evaluate your own life in this area of consistency? Does your life reflect fruit that is consistent with the character of God? On one occasion, a group of Jews came to John the Baptist, inquiring about his preaching and seeking to be baptized by him. John challenged them by saying, "Bring forth fruits worthy of repentance." In Galatians 5:19 through 22, Paul contrasted the fruit of the Spirit with the fruit of the flesh. The fruit of the flesh, he said, consists of such things as jealousy, anger, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. In contrast, he said the fruit of the Spirit consists of things like love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. Well, obviously, there's a great difference between the two. But as children of light, we have got to exhibit the fruit of the Spirit. In failing to do so, we fail to put feet to our faith. Finally, if we are to put feet to our faith, we must walk cautiously. In Ephesians 5:15, we read, "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise." In the verses that follow, Paul helps us understand what it means to walk circumspectly. He says, "Make good use of every opportunity you have, because these are evil days." And then he adds, "Try to find out what the Lord wants you to do." As Christians, we must be very careful how we live, and we must live carefully. We are called to be deliberate in our approach to life. We cannot afford to simply drift through life. We have got to redeem the time. I mean, we of all people should know that our time here on earth is limited, and that while we are here, we've got to make the most of our time. Well, that calls for a sensitivity which looks to God's Spirit to lead, guide, and direct the path that we will follow day by day. As Jesus said, "As a youngster, I must be about my Father's business," so must we. Our goal each day should be to seek God's will for our life and then go on and do that which is pleasing to God. This calls for a very special kind of walk. In the Jainism religion, all forms of life are revered. And by that I mean all forms, from the highest to the lowest. And as a demonstration of this belief, many of the Jain monks will sweep the path ahead of them in order to avoid stepping on some innocent creature, a bug, for example. We might laugh at that, but at the same time, we truly do need to be more cautious in the way we walk. For we might very well be walking on some innocent human soul as we plod along in our unconcerned ways. Yes, we must learn to walk more cautiously. Well, having looked at these five different usages of the word walk in the book of Ephesians this morning, let me ask you, have you put feet to your faith? Many of us, I fear, have amputated the feet from our Christian life. Paul, throughout the book of Ephesians, speaks highly of the wonderful salvation that God has given us. But let's not also fail to notice that he calls for a walk that would make our faith come alive. And other New Testament writers would certainly concur with him. In the book of James, we read, faith without works is dead. In other words, we've got to practice what we preach, folks. We've got to practice what we believe. We've got to show what we believe. Somehow we've got to put feet to our faith. Have you been doing that? If not, would you consider making a commitment to do so right here and right now, today? Let's pray. Our Father, earlier in the service, we praise you for being a wonderful God, and we even gave you thanks for allowing us to be your children. And what a privilege that is. What an honor. But Lord, we know that with privilege comes responsibility. With gift comes demand. And when the responsibility we have, if we are your children, is to live like it, to walk like it. And Lord, we would admit that we don't always do that. But we've been reminded today through Paul's words that we should. And I pray that you would help us to walk the walk and not just be people who talk the talk. I pray that we truly will walk in the unity of the Spirit, that we'll walk as those who have a new character, that we'll have a consistency about our walk, we'll be careful how we walk, and that we'll truly walk the path of love. Father, we thank you that though our past may not be what it should, that that does not determine our future, but that with your help, all things are possible. And we can do better. We know we can with your help. And so we ask for that help today. Lord, help us to walk the walk you've called us to walk. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our invitation hymn this morning is number 285, Wherever He Leads, I'll Go. That's putting feet to your faith to make that kind of commitment. Wherever He leads, I'll go. And I do challenge you to think about your Christian life as we stand and sing. Have you truly put feet to your faith? Are you a person who talks the talk but who doesn't walk the walk? If so, maybe today you need to make some changes, make a commitment to do better. We would encourage you to do so. There may be folks here today who've never given their heart to Jesus Christ. And if that's the case, I hope that you'll carefully consider doing that this morning. That you would realize that that is the greatest need that you have in your life at this particular time to make things right with God. Jesus has already paid the price for your sins. He's done everything necessary for your salvation. All you must do is accept the free gift that he wants to give you today. There may be some here today who are visitors who are not a part of this church family but may feel God's tugging on their hearts during this invitation hymn to become a part of this church family. Please know that we would welcome you here. I feel like we have a wonderful church here, but we could always use more people. We need more, all we can get to serve the Lord here in this community. And if God's leading you, we invite you to come too. I hope as we stand and sing, it truly will be your desire to go to do whatever he leads, to go wherever he leads. Let's think about that. Let's pray about that. Let's stand and sing. Hymn number 285.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for your presence here today. I do want to encourage you to come back this evening. We kind of start our spring program this evening, having all of our discipleship classes meeting. Our children's choirs will be meeting, the youth, everything, our evening worship service as well. We do have 5 discipleship classes that do begin tonight. The Disciples' Prayer Life will be led by Susan Austin. That begins tonight. To Live as Christ, a study on the Apostle Paul, led by Madonna Millett. Walking Wisely, a study of wisdom, led by Mark Woods. Experiencing God, led by Charles White. And Ministry to the Hearing Impaired, led by Benita Summers. If one of those doesn't suit you, we will be having a study of the Gospel of Mark downstairs in the Fellowship Hall during the same hour. But what a wonderful opportunity you have to learn and to grow in your Christian walk by these discipleship classes and the things that we offer on Sunday night. And I hope you'll make every effort to be back tonight if you possibly can. We sing as our hymn of commitment in closing, 524, We're Marching to Zion. Let's sing together.
Come we.
Good morning. We'd like to welcome you to First Baptist Church on this beautiful Lord's Day. If you are a visitor, would you please take the visitor's card on the pew in front of you and fill that out so we will have a record of your visit. And there are a few announcements that we need to call your attention to this morning and many others for you to read on your own. First of all, I'd like to announce that the extra handbell rehearsal that was scheduled for this afternoon has been canceled. And handbells will meet at regular time after church. Also, on Thursday, the O Grow Team will be meeting at 6:50. And for the youth, the SALT Team has a meeting tonight at 5 o'clock, if you are a member of that. And also, the youth will be going ice skating next weekend, Saturday, February 17th. And you need to sign up for that. There's still time if you want to go. The biggest thing is our Valentine banquet on Monday night, and that will be at 6:30 in the Fellowship Hall. If you have not signed up for that, then it's not too late, and you can come even if you haven't signed up. We just kind of need a record of how many that we're going to have. Let's see, I believe most of the others are later on in the month, and so you can read those, and if there's anything you're interested in, they'll be in the bulletin again. And now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Let's stand together as we sing our opening hymn of praise, Worthy of Worship. That's hymn 3. Please stand. may be seated.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we come to you this morning with heavy hearts, some of us whose hearts are burdened with grief, some with problems that we think cannot be solved. And Lord, help us to remember that you can give us hope and peace and comfort. Help us to turn to you in times of need. Help us to clear our minds this morning, even if only for this hour, to listen to you and to listen to your word and study your word. We know, Lord, that you are always with us. You are ever near. If we will just be still long enough to hear your voice. And we ask you to hear us as we pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time, we're going to ask our children if they'll come forward for the children's sermon. Good morning, boys and girls. I'm so glad to have you here at church today. Thank you for coming. Today is February 11th, I think, and in 3 days we have a very special day. Anybody know what happens on February 14th?
Valentine's Day.
Valentine's Day. Very good. What's Valentine's Day all about? Anybody know? Okay. Maybe you'll get a Valentine card. Do you ever get Valentine cards? Or maybe a Valentine gift, maybe some candy or something like that. I brought you all some Valentine gifts today. Did you know that? Oh, I got one too. Great. Wonderful. Thank you. Y'all like Snoopy?
Yeah.
All right. Here you go. I'm going to give each of you one of these. Brooke, would you like one? You're good. Okay. Okay. All righty. What would y'all think if I didn't give Aaron one? Aaron, what would you think if I didn't give you one? You would think I wasn't a very good person. In that case, I'm going to give you one, okay? All righty. Well, boys and girls, in your extended session today, you're going to be learning about something that Jesus taught us a long time ago. And he taught us that we are supposed to love everybody. It wouldn't have been very nice if I didn't give Aaron one of the Valentines, would it? Because I'm supposed to be nice to Aaron, just like I'm supposed to be nice to everybody. Jesus taught us that. Jesus said, you've heard it said, you are to love your friends and hate your enemies. He said, that's not what I believe. Jesus said, you are to love everybody, including your enemies. Now, that's not easy to do, boys and girls. It's not easy at all. But that's what God expects of us. He expects us to love everybody. And I hope that's something that we can work on as we go through our lives. It's something we grown-ups certainly have to continue to work on. But the Bible says God loves everybody, and because we are God's children, we are to love everybody too. You all want to work on that with me? That's something, like I said, I have to keep working on, but I want to encourage you to learn to love everybody. I didn't know how many were going to be here today, so I got a whole bunch of extra one of these. If I give you all an extra one, would you give them to somebody that you love? Would you do that? Okay. Have you got somebody you can give one to? Yes, you do. There you go. Okay. All right. Boys and girls, let's bow our heads and thank God for loving us so much. And let's ask God to help us love other people too, okay? Dear God, we thank you that we can come to church today. One of the great things about coming to church is that we are reminded every time we come here how much you love us. When we see that cross up there in the sanctuary, we're reminded you loved us so much that you sent your only son to die for us. And we thank you for loving us so much, for loving us just as we are, for loving us unconditionally. And God, we're reminded today that just as you love us, we're expected to love other people, even those who are not always easy to love. And I pray that you would fill our hearts with love so that we might love everybody. And I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. Bonnie has already welcomed you, but I too want to welcome you to our services today. We welcome those who are watching on television. We welcome those of you who are visiting with us today. We do have a number of visitors with us this morning. We're always thankful when folks come our way, and we hope that you will feel welcome here. We certainly want you to. We're going to have as our fellowship hymn this morning, number 345, Now I Belong to Jesus. We'll sing that in a moment, but first we're going to stand and let our accompanist play through it a time or two. And that will give you an opportunity to greet the folks around you. Please take advantage of that opportunity and let people know you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord today. Let's stand and do just that.
Morning. Turn with me in your pew Bibles to Psalm 33. We'll read that together. You can find that on pages 549 and 550 in the pew Bibles, or 472 and 473 in the large print Bibles. Psalm 33. Let's read together. Sing joyfully to the Lord, you righteous. It is fitting for the upright to praise him. Praise the Lord with the harp. Make music to him on the 10-stringed lyre. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully and shout for joy. For the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all he does. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of his unfailing love. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, their starry host by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the waters of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of his heart through all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven, the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place, he watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army. No warrior escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. Despite all its great strength, it cannot save. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you.
Our hymn of response is 412, My Faith Has Found a Resting Place. We'll sing the first, second, and fourth verses.
Pray together. Our Father, we give thanks to you that you have saved us. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice of Jesus and for the life that we have in knowing him. Lord, we confess to you that too often, though we know you, we don't follow you. Lord, we hide away from our world, or we're in our world and not of you. Lord, teach us to be both in the world and to be of you, to love you and not to love the world that we're a part of. Father, teach us to be in the world, to show your love with others, to share with them who you are and what you have done for us and for them as well. And Father, as we do that, may they see the love that we have for you and the love that you have for us. Help us to truly be in the world and not of us. Help us to love you more and more every day. Teach us to love you. And we thank you for the love that you give us. As we go throughout the rest of our week, help us to follow you, to seek you with our hearts, and to try our best to serve. In all that we do. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand again. You'll find an insert in your bulletin. It's red. A hymn medley about love. Our love towards God and God's love towards us. These are very familiar hymns, so you won't need your hymn book. So let's stand and sing those together.
May we pray. We come to you, Lord, at this time to thank you for all your goodness and grace. You have blessed us with so many things, but we give so little back to you. We are selfish with not only our money, but our time and talents. Let us remember how much you gave for us, and let us remember that the gift of your Son Jesus is the greatest gift of all, and help us to be grateful enough to share this gift with others. We ask that you accept the gifts we bring for you, to you today, and may we give them with willing hearts. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Laura loves her little family. She's the kind of person who loves them with her life. But sometimes in the evening, when the world rests on her shoulders, the four walls closing in, she'll close her eyes. It's not like she misses being younger, though she never was on Vogue magazine or MTV. But her husband loves her dearly, and morning shows her clearly kiss her little baby girl. Laura, she's the queen of the world, can't imagine ever leaving now. Now that she's been saved by love, saved by love, listen to her quiet heart singing loud. Laura, she's been saved by love, saved by love. I know that she's been saved by love, saved by love, saved by love. There's nothing quite like my family's love to warm me. Nothing short of death's gonna ever leave me cold. But still at times it's lonely, And through it all, it only makes me love Jesus more. This is what he came here for. Can't imagine ever leaving now. Now that I've been saved by love, saved by love, he's gonna turn my crazy world back around. And I've been saved by love, saved by love. I know that I've been saved by love, saved by love.
You know, it's not too easy not to have your family around, not to have a wife, not to have a girlfriend, or anything like that. You do get lonely sometimes, but you gotta remember who saves you and what you're saved by.
No, I'm never leaving now. Now that I've been saved by love, he's gonna turn my crazy world back around. I know that I've been saved by love, I know that I've been saved by love, saved by love.
If you haven't been saved by love, you can today.
Thank you so much. I have to admit, I got a little excited this morning. I've been out of town this weekend. When I got to church this morning, there was a bulletin on my desk, and I opened up, looked to see who was doing the special music, and it said Amy Grant. And then I looked over, and I saw Wills. I said, oh, shucks. Amy looks a lot better than Wills. But I appreciate Will's testimony and song, and appreciate him so much. You all may have witnessed a first this morning in all the history of Baptists. I don't know that Baptists have ever had trouble taking an offering till today. It's incredible. If there's one thing that Baptists do well, it's take offerings. And that may have been a first time today in all the history of Baptists that they had a little bit of difficulty. Let me ask you to turn in your pew Bibles to 1 John chapter 2. This morning we're going to read together verses 15 through 17. We'll read this out loud as a part of our worship, and as we read, we certainly want to listen for God's voice, His Spirit, to move in our hearts. 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. Let's read God's Word together. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, and the boasting of what he is and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but the man who does the will of God lives forever. May God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word today. They say love is grand, but I'm not sure that's always true. It can make you do some pretty stupid stuff. Take, for example, the following poem a young lady once wrote. I climbed up the door and I shut the stairs. I said my shoes and took off my prayers. I shut off my bed and climbed into the light, and all because he kissed me goodnight. Proof positive. Love may cause brain damage. Seriously, love is a wonderful thing. A wonderful thing, that is, if it is directed toward a worthy object. In our scripture passage this morning, John reminds us that we must be careful about who are what becomes the object of our love. When it comes to love, he points out, we've got to be choosy. He begins with the disturbing words, do not love the world or anything that belongs to the world. Then he adds, if you love the world, you do not love the Father. These words can't help but sound a bit strange to our ears this morning. I mean, it's almost as though we hear John saying the world is evil. But I thought the Bible said the world's good. That when God created the world, he said it's very good. And what is it that we read in John 3:16? Doesn't it say there that God so loved the world that he gave his only Son? John's words do seem a bit out of order, but only until we understand what he means by the word world in this particular passage. In the present context, world refers to humanity organized in rebellion against God. Throughout his letter, John stresses the importance of obedience to the Word of God. And here he is thinking of the attractions of a life lived in opposition to the will of God. One in which God's laws for the use of the world and the things in the world are disobeyed. What John is denouncing here is not so much the world as it is worldliness. In his opinion, the person who finds his or her greatest delight and satisfaction in worldly matters does not, in reality, love God. In the following verse, John defines more clearly what he has in mind when he forbids the children of God to love the world. Listen again in a different translation to verse 16. It says, everything that belongs to the world, what the sinful self desires, what people see and want, and everything in this world that people are so proud of, none of this comes from the Father. It all comes from the world. John offers for us here three descriptions of those worldly things which are not worthy of our love. The first of these, he says, is what the sinful self desires. In some translations, these words read the desires of the flesh. Although in Paul's writings, the word flesh usually carries sexual overtones, that's not the case in John's writing. You may recall that John earlier said that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. In John, flesh refers to the human as distinct from the divine. And thus the phrase, the desires of the flesh, signifies all the sinful tendencies of man. It's our hungering for those things that God would not have any part in. The second thing that John says is not worthy of our love is what people see and want. This is elsewhere translated the lust of the eyes. In biblical thought, the eyes are often the source of desire. In the book of Genesis, we read that the forbidden tree was seen by Eve to be pleasant to the eyes and desirable. Jesus himself noted how the eye can become the source of evil, and even encouraged that we pluck our eye out before we allow it to lead us into sin. Yes, our eyes can get us into a lot of trouble. But just what is it that people see and want that can lead to such trouble? Well, in today's world, material wealth might be one answer, power another. All the various forms of media today direct our eyes toward that which is sensual and erotic. And the list is literally endless. Today we desire so much. John warns us about eyes hungry for all they see. The third thing John mentions as being unworthy of our love is everything in this world that people are so proud of. And this is elsewhere translated pride in possessions. Interestingly enough, the word possessions here, the Greek word that is used, is also a word that means life. While the word pride refers to boasting and arrogance. How then are we to understand this phrase, pride in possessions? One of the most highly respected New Testament scholars, Raymond Brown, offers us three possibilities. He says, first, John might mean pride about one's means of livelihood, boasting about wealth, displaying possessions, and conspicuously expending them. Second, he says John might be referring here to pride about one's lifestyle and boasting about one's social status. And third, he says John could have been referring to overconfidence stemming from the security of one's own life. Well, all three possibilities describe a world into which the light of God's Son has not yet penetrated, a world characterized by darkness and sin. And that is what John means when he summarizes all that he has written about in verse 16 by saying, "None of this comes from the Father." There is for John two levels of life. There is life from above, and then there is life from below. The life that Christ came to give, the life from above, is salvation and is life eternal. And in this passage, John is urging us to concentrate on true life, the life from above. Now, that is not to dismiss the importance of life from below, that life which is described in verse 16. For clearly, all people need possessions. And therefore, it cannot be wrong to want and to take pleasure in what God has provided for our earthly needs. But when we begin to desire more than other people have, when we begin to covet whatever we see, to boast about what we have, and start to think that we are self-sufficient, well, then our desires have become perverse and sinful, and we stand condemned. Then we stand in the need of John's strong warning not to love the world or the things of the world. God would rather have us focus on that which is most important, that which is spiritual in nature. He realizes that you cannot divide your loyalties. Jesus said you cannot serve God and money. He warned of the dangers of accumulating riches on earth, and suggested that we store up treasures in heaven instead. It is this line of thinking that John takes up in verse 17. John says, "The world and everything in it that people desire is passing away." Here we find still yet another reason why we've got to be choosy about what we love. Why? Because some things are not worthy of our love. And why not? Because they do not last. What John is saying here is that people who attach themselves to the world's aims and to the world's ways are giving their lives to things which literally have no future. All the things that John has mentioned here are passing away. None of them have any lasting permanency. Well, that's a hard lesson for some of us to learn. We live so much for today. We do not live our lives cognizant of the fact that this world is not all that there is, that this time that we spend here on earth is only a drop in the bucket compared to the time we shall spend eternity with God. I mean, really, how do 70 or 80 years here on earth compare to eternity? And yet so many of us live as though those 70 or 80 years are all that we have. Of course, that's the way the devil wants us to think. He would have us be earthly rich while at the same time being spiritually bankrupt. John, however, alerts us to this scheme and encourages us to concentrate on that which has eternal value. The object of our love should not be that which passes away, but that which remains forever. Only such objects, he says, are truly worthy of our love. But what are such objects? Realistically speaking, just what is worthy of our love? Is there anything that lasts forever? Well, of course there is. God lasts forever. And he is by all means the most worthy object of our love. He is in fact the source of our love. Later in this same letter we read from this morning, John will say, "We love because he first loved us." As the source of our love, God is to be the supreme object of our love. Jesus himself noted that the greatest commandment of all is what? To love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your strength. Our very purpose in living is to love God and to enjoy Him forever. We are to love God more than anything or anyone else. And doing so includes loving the things that God loves, loving the things that God stands for, things that are true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and honorable. These are the things that will last forever. And thus, these are the things that are worthy of your love and mine. There's still another object worthy of our love, and it is one that John stresses throughout his epistle. And that is the children of God, our fellow believers. In 1 John 2:25, John says, "And this is what Christ Himself promised to give us, eternal life." You see, we, along with our fellow Christians, also last forever. For that reason, John repeatedly tells us that we should love our brothers and sisters in Christ. In fact, he claimed that if we love our fellow Christians, we walk in the light. But he says, if we do not love our fellow Christians, we walk in darkness. In chapter 3, verse 23, he adds, "What God commands is that we believe in His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as Christ commanded." I find that very intriguing that on the same level with believing in Christ, John places loving one another. Later in chapter 4, he will write, "If someone says he loves God but hates his brother, guess what? He's a liar. For he cannot love God whom he has not seen," he says, "if he does not love his brother whom he has seen. The command that Christ has given us is this: whoever loves God must love his brother also." Folks, there's no getting around it. In God's opinion, our fellow Christians deserve our love. They are, after all, family, like it or not. And since they are family, and we will be spending eternity with them, we have no choice but to love them right here and right now. It is commanded. Once again, John insists we cannot love God if we do not also love our brothers and sisters in Christ. I guess you could say that it is a package deal that God offers us. He says, "You take me, you take my family too." Doesn't get much clearer than this. Our fellow Christians are worthy of our love. And we ought to be doing everything we can to love them. And then I think I would add to the list of things worthy of our love, ourselves. Now some of you may say, "Chuck, that sounds pretty egotistical." But it's not, not really. Do you remember what Jesus said when he was talking about the great commandment? He said, "Love God with everything you've got." And then he said, "Love your neighbor." But how did he say we are to love our neighbor? Can you answer me? As ourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love for self is both healthy and needful. In fact, self-love is required if we are going to experience the abundant life here and now and eternal life in the hereafter. Now, by self-love, I obviously do not mean selfishness, nor an attitude which believes the world ought to revolve around oneself. That is the sin of pride. What I do mean is the healthy love that recognizes that we are all created in the image of God and as such are of infinite worth and value. A love that moves us to become all that we are meant to be. In recent years, one of the best-selling books in this country is named The Care of Soul, The Care of the Soul by Thomas More. It is a book which reminds us how important it is that we nourish and protect the priceless soul that God has created us to be. It is crucial that we all tend to the matters of the heart, the matters of the soul, but we are not likely to do that unless we recognize its value in God's eyes and begin to truly love it, to love ourselves. toward the end of chapter 3, John offers us all some very important advice. He says, "My children, our love should not be just words and talk. It must be true love, which shows itself in action." As we seek to love God, as we seek to love our fellow believers, as we seek to love ourselves, we must make sure that it is more than just talk. In concrete, visible ways, we've got to show our love for God. In concrete, visible ways, we've got to show our love for one another. And yes, in concrete, visible ways, we've got to show love for ourselves. Love is much more than talk. The Bible says we are to love in word and deed. That's something we need to be reminded of here around Valentine's Day. But it's also something that we need to be reminded of over and over again. As Christians, we are called to be people who prove their love for others by our actions. We are called to be a people who love that which lasts, that which is eternal. This morning, God's Word challenges us all to take a journey into our own hearts. And we're challenged to look around and see what it is we find there. Are the things that we are loving most worldly and temporal, or are they spiritual and eternal? Are we loving what matters most? Loving God, our fellow believers, ourselves, both in word and deed. This morning it is my prayer, and I hope you'll make it your prayer too, that God will fill each of our lives with love. Love for what really matters. Let's pray. Father, this time of the year we do pause to celebrate love, and we thank you for those that love us and those that you've given us to love. We thank you for special people, maybe our spouses, our children, our parents. But on this particular day, we thank you for your love. And we thank you that it is because of your love that we are enabled to love others. And Father, I pray that every person in this room, every person who's watching this program, will know that they are loved by you unconditionally and will be forevermore. We thank you for that love, and today we celebrate that love together. Father, we've also been reminded today that we are to love and to be very careful and even choosy about what and who we love. I pray that you would help us to love that which matters most, that we truly will begin to love you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, that we will be able to love our neighbor, and that we'll also be able to love ourselves. Father, help us to do this. And I pray that in the process, glory will come to you. And I pray that this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn of invitation this morning is number 210. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior thou art. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. Are you loving what matters most? You know, you would think that we folks who come to church, that we would have that answer right. And we say, sure. But I have to admit, that's not always the case for me. It's easy for me sometimes to let my priorities go where they shouldn't be. And maybe it's to give too much emphasis, too much of my time, too much of my love to things that really don't matter, that don't last. So I think it's good to do an inventory, to look into the heart this morning. And I would encourage you to do that during this time of invitation. And maybe today would be a good time for you to renew your commitment to Jesus Christ and to putting him first, to making your love for him your highest priority. If you're not doing that, maybe today is the day you need to begin. If you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ, I hope that you would respond by coming today and responding to God's love for you, a love so great that he gave his only son for you. That Son loved you so much He died on the cross for you, so that your sins might be forgiven, so that you might know life in all of its fullness, so that you might live forever. It is a gift He would like to give you today. There may be some here today who would like to become a part of this church fellowship. Come serve the Lord with us. Please know that you would be welcome here. We're going to let the Spirit move. We're going to ask you to listen carefully in your heart as we sing. And if the Lord is speaking to you today, we invite you to come now. Let's stand. Hymn number 210, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Thank you so much for your presence here today. I hope you'll be back tonight for one of the discipleship classes or for the evening worship. Also hope that we'll see you tomorrow evening for our annual Valentine's banquet. It will be a wonderful meal and time of fellowship. Some of our youth and children have some skits prepared for us as well, and I think there'll be some other special entertainment. It's a night you won't want to miss, so come join us tomorrow night. I believe it's at 6:30 in the fellowship hall below. Again, I'm really glad to have you here today. Again, we welcome especially our guests. We thank you for coming to be with us. We close our service this morning with a hymn of commitment, hymn number 161. Crown Him with Many Crowns. We'll sing verse 4 as we leave.